Okay, in this quick bite, we're going to talk about choosing the right chart. Now, there's a lot of charts that you have access to, and you may have only made a few charts in your life, but I find a lot of people, what they do when they sit down to create some data viz is they go right to the type of chart that they're going to create without thinking about the little behind the scenes part first. So the first thing that you want to think about when you are creating a chart is, what's the point of the data that I'm going to share? What's the point of me sharing this data visually anyway in the first place? And that's going to sort of depend on the story that you want to tell, or what story that specific piece of data might be sharing. So things to think about is, do you want to share with people or your reader what you want to highlight, something that's the most and the least in something? Do you want to highlight the difference between two things? Are you looking at change over time? Maybe it's just between two points, like pre and post, or change between two groups, things like that. All of those questions are really going to impact the type of chart that you want to create, or the type of charts that you want to create. So we often say, why don't you go ahead and write it down in a sentence or two? What is the point of this chart? And that's going to help you figure out the types of charts that you might have access to. Once you are kind of clear on that, you can sort of dive into your software. And here's my PowerPoint chart picker right here. There are a lot of different charts in PowerPoint that you can choose from, just sort of by stock or built-in charts or default charts. Data Wizards will call them the native charts to PowerPoint. There's lots of different things here, but these are the basics. These are the standard charts most of the time. Once you get further down on that list, when you see the things like the tree maps and the sunbursts and the histograms, those are maybe a little less common, and we might not need to use those very often. But the ones on the top, the column charts, the line charts, the pie charts, bar charts, these are the ones that we're probably going to gravitate towards most. But there are a lot of other charts that you might want to consider for your vocabulary. And two resources that I really love for thinking about all the different charts that we might want to use in our context are the chart choosers that are provided by Ann K. Emery over at Depict Data Studio, and the chart chooser site that's provided by Storytelling with Data. There's a really great overview of these charts. They're clickable. Lots of times they come with tutorials or reasons why you would want to use those charts. So I want you to go to those sites. The links are right there. And I want you to go and check out all the different charts and kind of beef yourself up in terms of the chart vocabulary that you have. There's lots of different charts to use. And once you know a lot of the different chart types, you're going to be a more effective data viz designer. Now, I've kind of come up with a little bit of a cheat sheet for you, a handout for some of the charts that I use most often in my work as a program evaluator. So we start with these default or built-in charts, the pie chart, the bar and column chart. A lot of times, if you have a pie chart, especially with a lot of slices, you're going to go ahead and get rid of that altogether and turn it right into a bar chart or a column chart, because we know we really don't want to have a pie chart for with many, many slices. My rule, in fact, is just that I only use a pie chart for one slice, just to highlight one piece of data or a proportion from a population. But if you want to get a little bit more fancy and you want to show a single number, how about considering something like a waffle chart or an icon array? Something about these icons is also very easy for our eyes to sort of perceive, for our brains to kind of understand and perceive a little bit better than that curvature or that angle that the pie chart provides us with. And so you might want to consider these if you're thinking about highlighting a single number. Icon arrays aren't always going to be appropriate for your setting, but there might be a lot of reporting settings for which they could be. Now, the default option or the built-in option for kind of showing two groups or comparing two groups over time or two groups together are this clustered bar chart, the paired bar chart option in Excel or PowerPoint. But if you wanted to break free of this default, why don't we consider a side-by-side bar chart, pulling those bar charts apart so that one of them is next to each other. And you can do this with two sets of bars, three sets of bars, four sets of bars, however many sets of bars that you have. What about a back-to-back chart or a population pyramid? This can be a really great option if you're trying to highlight some sort of asymmetry between two groups. If two groups are totally equal, those bars would be flat on both sides. But if one or two of the items was unequal, was disproportional between those two groups, one of them is going to be very small and one of them is going to be very large. These back-to-back charts can really make that story pop out a little bit better than just those paired bar charts by default. And then, of course, we have the dumbbell dot plot, which, of course, we love. Dumbbell dots are really great at highlighting the difference between groups, the gaps between two groups to show. And so this can also be a really nice way to highlight single points along that line. showing change over time. We obviously really do this quite often with line charts like this, but line charts can get really messy really quickly, and this is what you'll hear people call the spaghetti line chart. There are a bunch of lines overlapping each other, and those kind of get a little wild. So when you have a situation like this, whether it's lines or bars or something else, when it gets really complicated, ask yourself if you can pull it apart into small multiples. Maybe you can go ahead and just create miniature versions of single charts and compare those side by side instead of plopping them all together on a single chart. Or maybe you could consider, if you actually don't need to show change over lots of points in time, maybe you only need to show the change between point A, the first point, and point B, the last point. And you can create a slope chart, which is basically just a line chart with two points, but it's stylized a little bit different. It has, it's usually kind of longer and taller, and you can see that you really have a nice pre and post the slope. This is really great when you have lots of things that maybe are not changing that much, and one thing that really changes a lot, either down or up, you can really see that slope pretty nicely. And then another version of the dumbbell, you can make a vertical dumbbell plot, and that could be really useful for some change over time, where you can see the gap changing between two groups over time or something like that. We're going to deal with a lot of survey data in our work, and so this stacked bar chart is a pretty common option for people to go to. You've seen them probably a lot in different reports, but sometimes they can get really messy and really busy pretty quickly. So let's think about how we can maybe simplify that and maybe group things together, or let's think about maybe a diverging option where we actually create a cut point in the middle, you know, maybe the positive responses on the right and the negative responses on the left, and we sort these data so that they kind of become these floating bars, and we create this axis of orientation in the middle, so I can really now quickly see what were the positive responses and what were the negative responses, who was most positive, who was least positive, etc. So these diverging stacked bar charts are a pretty good option there. And then we have the dot plots, one of my favorite charts, one of the first charts I learned how to make in Excel over at Stephanie Evergreen's blog. It was an awesome blog post. I'll link to that one below. But dot plots are really nice when you want to show a single value over time. I really like dot plots in our case, in our sort of environments, for showing average scores. A lot of times we are averaging things like Likert scales or other survey scales, and we always visualize those averages or means with a bar chart. Those are not the best ways to visualize averages or means or those kinds of summary statistics. So let's go ahead and create a dot plot for those summary statistics. It's much more accurate to our eye. So that's another great option right there. And then also the thing that I love to make these really quite a bit is these framed bar charts. They're really great for survey data, especially when you have select all that apply questions, because I think that extra little buffer, that gray buffer zone, these are kind of like progress bars. I think that progress, those buffer bars really create sort of this idea that like every response could be selected by 100% of the respondents. So those are really nice for things like check all that apply or select all that apply questions. So these are just a few of those charts that you have access to. And I think that you should think about some of these when you are going to visualize your data. Now, in the next section, we are gonna talk about making more effective charts. So we're gonna start talking, now that we know a little bit about some of the charts that we can make, we're gonna start talking about all those little tips and tricks, those quick wins that we can use to make our charts that much better. Stay tuned.